The Obama administration proposed new and tougher safety rules today for railway trains carrying oil, trains sometimes referred to as a pipeline on wheels. They come after some tragic derailments and at a time when more than 1 million barrels of oil a day are traveling across the country by rail. Jeffrey Brown has the story.
On July 6th of last year at 1:15 in the morning, the small Canadian town of Lac Megantic was rocked by a powerful explosion. A runaway train carrying 72 cars of crude oil had careened into the community and derailed. The blast and ensuing fire destroyed dozens of buildings and killed 47 people. The train carried Bakken oil, a highly flammable crude from western North Dakota, where production has surged along with rail shipments. Overall, the number of tanker cars carrying oil in the U.S. soared from 10,000 in 2008 to more than 400,000 last year.
They didn't look down the road to figure out how are we going to get this to market in a safe way.
Don Morrison of the Dakota Resource Council spoke to the NewsHour last May.
Going through people right next to people's houses and businesses, it's dangerous. And they got to be careful.
Now the Department of Transportation is proposing new regulations for oil trains. They would include the phase-out or retrofit of thousands of older tank cars within 2 years, improved braking systems, and testing corn-based ethanol and crude oil for flammability prior to transportation. The goal is to prevent the kinds of accidents seen from Lynchburg, Virginia to Castleton, North Dakota over the last 18 months, though none was as deadly or destructive as Lac Megantic. For the record, the Castleton incident involved the rail company BNSF, a major carrier of oil, and an underwriter of the NewsHour. Still, industry representatives like Ron Ness of the North Dakota Petroleum Council insist the transportation of oil by rail is sound.
Safety is certainly the number one aspect that I think all aspects of the transportation industry are focused on. And at 99.7% of the time, you know, rail movements get to their destination safely.
Supporters of the long-delayed Keystone Pipeline project to carry Canadian oil to the Gulf of Mexico say that it would ease the need for oil trains. Environmental groups counter that it poses its own threats.
Secretary of Transportation Anthony Foxx announced the proposed rules today, and he joins me now. Welcome to you.
Thank you, Jeff.
First, to help people understand the situation as you see it, how serious a health and a public safety issue is it, especially for these towns where trains are running through?
Well, we have to remember that our oil production in this country is growing exponentially, and in fact, crude by rail shipments have increased from 2008 with 9,500 carloads to more than 415,000 carloads, a 4,000% increase. We don't see that abating anytime soon, so the production is going to increase. Our safety standards have to increase with it, and that's why we promulgated, at least proposed the rule today.
The criticism that came immediately is that you're moving in the right direction, but much too slowly. I want to put up a graphic we got from Earth Justice, one of the activist groups. It says that your proposals show extreme, unacceptable risk posed by an outdated and accident-prone type of rail car, the DOT 111. The department's proposal delays reducing the risk by keeping these outdated, accident-prone cars on the rails for at least 3 to 6 more years. So the question, why wait so long if it's so dangerous?
Well, look, let's first of all say that we're trying to push this rule out as quickly as possible. We have a 60-day comment period, and folks who have criticisms or improvements they like to see to the rule, we're inviting them to use the comment period. But to the particular question you asked, the reality is that we have a market that has at best a third of new tank cars in it today. And so to transition the market, it's going to take some time just from a practical standpoint. We want to have the right standard set for the new tank car, and that's what we're proposing is to have alternatives to improve the tank car standard. But this is also a comprehensive rule. It deals with speed. It deals with other aspects of this issue so that we can ensure the safety of American people.
But you're getting pressure from the industry not to move too fast because of the expense of changing those cars or retrofitting those cars?
We are, again, using the comment period to hear from industry, but we're not going to be bound by what we hear from industry. We're going to do the right thing for safety in America, and whatever that is where our final rule is going to be.
All right. Now, one really interesting issue of this is the particular oil involved. Now, it sounds as though your department concluded that Bakken oil is actually particularly volatile and less safe and more combustible than other kinds of oils?
Yes, one of the things that we're noticing in this situation is that in the Bakken region, there is rudimentary separation occurring before it goes into tank cars. In other parts of the country where there's more of a history of refining, there is refining infrastructure around it. But in the Bakken, that generally is not the case. And what the tank cars are doing is moving that material out to the refining areas on the east and west coasts. So the challenge we have is that we have a relatively unstable substance that is moving long distances and sometimes hundreds of cars at a time.
Here you got pushback from the oil industry. I'll put up a graphic that we got from the American Petroleum Institute. The best science and data do not support recent speculation that crude oil from the Bakken presents greater than normal transportation risk. And they're calling on you to make sure you get your science right.
So
you feel like you have your science right?
Yeah, I do. We actually, we have some folks saying we're moving too slow, some people saying we're moving too fast. We're probably in the right place with this rule. We're going to look forward to the comment period and listen to what folks have to say about it.
What about the issue of the speed? Because that's something you're still looking at. There's a question of a 40-mile-per-hour speed limit, which I gather now the railroads have accepted within urban areas, but the question is whether you should expand that countrywide.
Yeah, the question is, do we have a 40-mile limit totally everywhere? Do we have a 40-mile limit around certain parts given population differences? Do we have it just in urban areas? That type of challenge is not just a challenge that's inherent to this issue of crude by rail. There's also an issue of what it does to other commodities, grains, rail, moved by rail, corn products moved by rail. And so, again, this is a place where we'll listen to input from a variety of stakeholders and work to craft the rule accordingly.
Well, how do you decide something like that? Is it based on the new cars or the brake? I mean, because all these things are tied together,
right?
That's right. You're also calling for a new kind of braking system, or at least looking at the system.
The complexity of this cannot be understated. It is very complex, and we actually need a comprehensive approach, which is why our rule takes into account all of those factors. As we get comments in, we're going to take a look at those comments, but I believe that you're going to see a rule that's going to have several components to it: the tank car standard, the speed standard, and other pieces, including braking and other things that you mentioned before.
The larger issue seems to me is where you started, is whether we've seen this huge increase in the production. So the question is the balance out of order, right? The balance of the increase in production versus maintaining the safety and our ability to transport this?
Well, the reality is that things have changed. This increased production, these trains are now moving, as I said before, in some cases 100 unit trains at a time, unit cars at a time. And we're going to have to deal with this new reality by stepping up our safety standards. And this rule is going to be promulgated to focus on not only where we are, but where we're likely to be in the future. And we want to make sure we hit the target with this rule.
And you know there have been a lot, especially in a lot of local communities, there have been a lot of protests, a lot of worry about this.
Yes, I'm very well aware. We've heard from members of Congress, we've heard from mayors, we've heard from community members all over the country and even into Canada. We understand the importance of this issue. That's why we've worked to get this rule out and have a public comment period, and we'll move it as quickly as we can.
All right, just in our last time together, while I have you here, I want to ask you about another thing that's another transportation issue on people's minds, and that's air transportation. We had what happened in the Ukraine. We have U.S. flights not going into Israel. Jet travel nowadays, should people be worried in a new way?
Well, I think what people should be reassured by is the fact that our FAA is working very closely with our intelligence community and with the international community to understand the risks of traveling. And when we believe that the risks are substantial enough, we have issued NOTAMs that prohibit U.S. carriers from flying into certain territories. So we will continue to monitor situations as they occur, and hopefully folks will feel safe as they fly.
But you do believe that is the situation into Israel right now, even though the Israeli government, we heard earlier on the program, says that's not the case?
Well, we are using the intelligence we have. Again, we're working with all of our international partners in situations where we have active NOTAMs, but we will continue to monitor the situation in Israel as well as elsewhere.
Anthony Foxx, Transportation Secretary, thank you so much.
Thank you.